Well, good evening, and thank you for that wonderful introduction, Linda. It's humbling to be considered one of the local heroes here in Riverside. Tonight, I hope to reach some of these objectives, including explore our collective experience with loss during the COVID-19 pandemic, discuss some of the common reactions to grief after someone dies, share ways to cope with grief following the death of a loved one, talk about effective ways to help someone else who is grieving, and a few suggestions on how to support the children in your life following a death. COVID-19, the coronavirus disease. I just want to invite you to take a moment right now just to reflect on this past year. Linda and I were talking before the webinar began, and we thought, what a coincidence is that we're having this discussion tonight, 1 year since the pandemic was actually declared. So where were you when it began? And how is life different for you today? The past 12 months have been an experience unlike most of us have seen in a lifetime. The COVID-19 pandemic wrought suffering and grief across the entire planet. Locally, our way of life shifted into an experience of fear, isolation, and for so many people, loss. Everyone's life has been affected. People lost their livelihood through the closing of businesses. They lost their independence as social groups, faith communities, and even recreational areas were literally locked down. Homebound isolation led some people to self-destructive behaviors, others to depression, and even violence. Many, many people were separated from their loved ones who may have gone to seek medical care for this mysterious virus. And we even continue to grapple with this a whole year after it started. At the beginning of the pandemic, the experience felt surreal to many of us. The things that were happening appeared to be happening over there or somewhere else. Over time, the influence of the virus crept closer and closer to our very own personal experience with it. More often, it became common to get word that someone we personally know has been struck with the illness. Sometimes we heard about people that we know who died from the virus. Many of us lost someone very close to us, someone that we love. Today, as I speak with you, over 3,500 lives have been lost in the county of Riverside alone. Nationwide, the numbers are staggering. Not too long ago, statistics reported that over 500,000 people have died here in the United States, and lost lives are still being counted. But I'm not here this evening to quote statistics or to muse about the headlines. I'm here this evening to address the matters of the heart, to speak to the common experience that we're sharing as friends, as neighbors, and to share with you from my experience in serving people at the end of life. The focus of my talk this evening is not to emphasize the devastation of our collective human experience. The focus is to explore how each of us individually have been touched by loss and grief during this time, specifically the grief that one feels when someone that is very close to them dies. I'm sharing with you from my very own personal experience serving as a professional chaplain on the front lines of COVID-19. Many of the vignettes I may share with you tonight are from my service as a hospital chaplain. Some are from my service as a hospice chaplain. In all cases, except for my personal family stories, names and identifiers have been changed for privacy. There are many publications, psychological studies, media reports, and even personal anecdotes about many different types of loss. COVID-19, however, has brought forth a unique experience of grief. Maybe it's the isolation, the inability to gather with friends and family in the ways that we've grown accustomed to in our society, the inability to engage in our common rituals and ceremonies. But it's even more than that. The pandemic has kept us from even being at the bedside of our loved ones when death is near. Final words of love and comfort have been silenced or relegated to a video camera in a tiny handheld device. Funerals are postponed or not held at all. Mortuaries at times have been full to capacity, turning people away. Last rites and parting words have been held in abeyance or not uttered at all. Even under usual circumstances, the journey into and through grief can be and must be a life-altering, terrible experience. This evening, I would like to address some of the current theories related to grief and, I hope, leave you with a sense of how one might navigate through the experience of grief. Finally, my wish is to convey a sense of help for today and hope for tomorrow. Because as surely as the sun will rise, this too shall pass. My current experience has been that mortuaries are overcrowded and they have turned people away. Funeral services are backed up and scheduled weeks into the future. Small groups are allowed at gravesides for short abbreviated gatherings, and some people were not able to gather at all to commemorate their loved one. We've seen multitudes of reports in the news media portraying individual stories of loss. There have even been exhibits created to commemorate healthcare workers and the dead, displayed in museums where entrance is still prohibited. There have been online memorials and video live streaming for everything from 12-step meetings to church services. Life as we knew it 1 year ago is now indelibly changed. Maybe you're here tonight participating because someone that you know personally has died from COVID or from other causes. Maybe you have a friend or a family member who has lost a loved one. Or maybe you're just curious and you wonder about our common human experience these days. No matter what your current experience is with loss, I pray that you will glean even a small bit of information or insight that may help you either now or in the future. And I hope that your own inherent wisdom will be sparked as you recall your own experiences with grief and loss. It's something that we all share in common. It's part of our collective consciousness. It's part of being alive and being human. Death is inevitable. It is so very sad and unfortunate that death has become so much more of our daily awareness in these days of COVID-19. The pandemic has brought forth situations unlike any of us have experienced before. I recall the very first day in the hospital when visitation was totally restricted to the public. Imagine dropping off your partner or spouse at the emergency room and not being able to go inside with them. Imagine receiving a telephone call from the clinical team, from the doctor or nurse informing you that your loved one is being admitted into the intensive care unit and not being able to be by their side. Some of you on this webinar don't need to imagine that. Some of you here tonight actually experienced it. And I pray that you had a positive outcome. But not all people have been fortunate in that respect. Many people, very sadly, died alone. In psychology and grief therapy, we consider these types of losses to be ambiguous loss or even disenfranchised grief. Typically, a traumatic loss is when a death is the result of a horrific accident. But for the purpose of this conversation, I'm sure that you would agree losing someone under the circumstances that we have seen with COVID-19 has created a trauma for all of us collectively. The stories that we have seen and heard portrayed on the media paint a picture of loneliness and helplessness. As a hospital chaplain, I stood at the bedside of far too many people who were not able to have a family member at their side. I wore full and complete protective gear, and I did my very best to connect to families through video conference and sometimes telephone. I was also present to many staff people of all disciplines, housekeepers, nurses, physicians, phlebotomists, all of them, many of them contracting the illness and even dying from the virus. Some of them lost family members of their own. When I was making my rounds on the medical intensive care unit, I used to stop outside of each of the patient's windows. And if they were awake, I would wave at them and they would wave back. And sometimes I would hold up a rosary from one of our churches here in Riverside, and they would smile. And then later the nurse would come and take the rosary and hang it on their IV pole. One day I was at a window and there was a man sitting in his bed, and he just had the biggest smile and he was waving back at me. And suddenly a face popped up in the window and I realized it was a nurse, but it wasn't just any nurse. It was one of my nurses, one of my ICU nurses. The man in the bed was Raul, and the nurse in the window was his daughter, Lexi. It was her father who was there with COVID. He was there for a few weeks, and over time, Lexi painted a great big green heart in the window of his hospital room. And every single evening, his family and friends would gather on the street corner and look up at that green heart in the window and wave and just, you know, send best wishes to Raul. Very unfortunately, after about 3 weeks, his body succumbed to the illness and he died. It's been a long and hard journey for people like Lexi. It's been really hard for other people who are standing by and trying their best to serve. And what I've come to realize is that under any circumstances, no matter what the loss is, whether it's a worldwide pandemic or some other type of grief that we're experiencing from death, grief is very personal. So tonight, I want to invite you to think about, what was the first time that you personally experienced the death of a loved one? And since that time, what are some of the most significant losses that you've endured? I recall as a 12-year-old girl, my grandfather, my Ota, died very suddenly. I remember coming home from school and relatives were starting to arrive, and my mom and my aunties were all crying. It was really confusing. And later on that night, we went to the mortuary to view his body. And it was the first time that I saw a dead body in a casket. I'll always remember that. It stuck with me my whole life. But even though we've all had experiences with death, it still remains a very taboo subject in our culture. At best, people are uncomfortable talking about it, and at worst, people avoid it altogether. This is not helpful when you're trying to be a true support to someone who's had grief. This is not helpful when you find yourself in a situation that calls for difficult decisions, such as an unexpected medical crisis or an imminent death. As a Christian, I've often heard my faith family say things like, "I'm not afraid of dying. I know where I'm going." But not everybody has that belief. And even if a person does have a hopeful belief about life after death, many people fear how they're going to get there, the journey along the way. Fear, judgment, and our own grief can become barriers to our ability to help someone else. It's not possible to compare one death or one loss or one grief to another grief. And it's much different when it's your loss than when you are supporting someone else with their loss. 5 years ago, my father had a traumatic brain injury, and my mother and brother and I walked alongside of him as he went from the ICU to rehab, back to the ICU, back to the rehab, back to the ICU, back and forth. It was a terrible, prolonged experience watching my father literally die before my eyes. And there I was, a clinical chaplain, a board-certified clinical chaplain with master's degrees and all kinds of training. And I was literally a mess. So it's just not the same when it's somebody who's close to you. To the person who's experiencing the pain of loss, that grief might feel very lonely. They may feel like it's the worst possible situation that they've ever endured. Your experience with loss may be totally different from someone else's experience, but being familiar with your own memories and emotions is what will help you to be authentic and truly empathic with someone who you are helping. But with all of the grief theory, all of the experts, all of the many, many years and studies about grief, the very most important information is from your own personal experience. You are the expert of your own grief. Sure, psychology does offer framework and theory. However, you and only you truly know what that experience is like. Our cultural practice of denying death and dying is also reflected in how we experience grief and grieving. Stuffing our feelings, acting brave when we feel like our world has ended, isolating ourselves, leads to deep misery and worse pain. My personal experience is that the best balm for a grieving soul is the opportunity to share our story over and over and over. Our story about significant loss will remain with us in the days and years to come as the seasons of our grief change. My mother, who's now going to be 84 years, lost her mother when she was a child and they were in a starvation camp in Yugoslavia after World War II. My mom describes a horrific, very, very sad scene of herself and her two sisters literally laying on top of their mom's body, sobbing. And my mom frequently talks about that memory. So you see, those memories, those early memories, they do stick with us. And even if we think we've forgotten them, sometimes they come back to the surface. But tonight, I just want to remind you that as a helping person, listening to another person's story is a spiritual practice. Listening with full presence and without judgment is a sacred gift that you can give to someone else. But let's talk about some of the psychological theories about grief that you might be familiar with. I think most of us by now are familiar with Elizabeth Kubler-Ross, and we're familiar with those stages of grief: denial, anger, bargaining, depression, acceptance. When Dr. Kubler-Ross created the stages of grief, she actually did that when she was studying people who were at the end of life. But today we kind of attribute those stages to grief as well. When we think of denial, it's when somebody's thinking, this can't possibly be happening to me. As a hospital chaplain, it reminds me of so many scenes where a patient's receiving CPR, even though the clinical team is aware that it's futile and that the patient ultimately is going to die, they defer to the family to make that decision to stop those heroic measures. That's denial. Or anger. I think of so many times in the intensive care unit when someone was a victim of a trauma, and one family in particular where a young man was hit by a hit and run driver and killed. And I remember his parents just really focused not so much on their son and his suffering and making decisions about his end of life care, but more about revenge and punishing the driver of the car. Asking, why is this happening to us, and who can we blame? That's anger. Or bargaining. I remember one father on the intensive care unit. His 18-year-old son lived most of his life with a very acute lung disease, and he had respiratory arrest at home. And his father at home tried to resuscitate his son, and he actually was able to get him on the ambulance and to the hospital. And there was his father at the bedside, just literally begging, praying to God, make this not happen. Make this not happen. Save my son. Give him a chance. And of course, we're familiar with that depression. But eventually, there's a time that comes where we can say, I'm at peace with what happened. But after Kubler-Ross and many, many psychologists, theorists, about 40 years later, Dr. J. William Warden published his philosophy about the tasks of mourning. Dr. Warden knew that there were certain things that people needed to do in order to progress through grief. And he talked about things like accepting the reality of the loss, acknowledging the pain of the loss, adjusting to a new environment, and reinvesting in the reality of a new life. I remember One Legacy, if you're familiar with One Legacy, they are the organ donor foundation. They would come when families were with a family member who was at end of life that was an organ donor. And we would have an annual remembrance ceremony at the hospital. And I remember after one ceremony that I officiated, a mom came to me and she asked me if I would take her to the ICU, to the room where her son died. By doing that, she told me that it really helped her to accept her loss. But also acknowledging the pain of the loss. You know, how many times have you been with somebody that just over and over and over wants to talk about their grief? And after a while, people who are in grief feel like it's a burden to constantly share this story. So they start talking to strangers. I go to grocery shopping in Sun City with my mom, and I noticed that a lot of the folks there, a lot of the older people who are widows and widowers, will just literally stop in the aisles and talk about their husbands and wives who've died. And then there's adjusting to a new environment. You know, after a person's become widowed or lost an adult child, you know, there's different life changes that they go through, maybe moving into a different home, or engaging with family and friends without their partner. And reinvesting in the reality of a new life, maybe going to a grief support group, cultivating new friendships, new hobbies and interests, and just simply being okay with being alone. But earlier I talked about telling the story over and over. And in my personal practice as a helping professional, as a chaplain, I draw upon the theories of Viktor Frankl. Dr. Frankl, some of you might be familiar with his famous book, Man's Search for Meaning. He wrote about his experiences in the World War II concentration camps. And Dr. Frankl was very fond of saying a person can endure anything as long as they understand why, as long as there's meaning. And so I've learned through my own practices walking alongside of people in grief or people who are dying that making meaning out of a situation, sharing stories and emotions helps to integrate the losses that we're enduring, helps us to make it part of our lives. And when we begin to form a relationship with our loved one that is different than before, when we can find meaning in that, it goes a long way to helping us feel less pain. When we learn that life is worth living and that we must endure, if not for ourselves, then we're ready to help others. So if you've ever had a loss, if you're very familiar with what it's like to go through grief, you might be familiar with some of these common reactions, physical reactions. People have told me about feeling extremely fatigued or exhausted, having headaches, feeling muscle tension or digestion problems, an empty feeling in their stomach, lump in their throat, or sudden bursts of crying. Cognitive reactions. People talk a lot about having difficulty concentrating or not being able to make decisions, having challenges with their memory, having dreams and nightmares, thinking things will never be normal again, questioning their own mortality, asking why, wishing that they could just change things, or being preoccupied with the loss. And a lot of times, memories of other past losses come up. And another really common cognitive reaction is experiencing signs that the loved one is near. Just the other night, I was talking to the wife of one of my hospice patients, and it was just a few days after her husband had died. And she told me that the other night she was walking through her living room, and she swore that her husband, Evan, was sitting in his recliner. And it just caused her to really do a double take and start to cry. A lot of people have experiences like that. And then, of course, there's emotional reactions. Sadness, shock, numbness, feeling helpless, feeling a lot of anxiety, anxiousness, having fear. Fear about the future without the loved one, fear about one's own death, having regret about things that maybe we did or didn't say, feeling guilty, or feeling detached. I know a lot of people get very irritable or angry. I know after my father died, my brother was very hard to live with. He was just so angry at my dad. People have a lot of denial. They feel alone and lonely. Sleeplessness, not being able to fall asleep, or feeling confused when they're awake. And of course, there's behavioral reactions, a lot of crying, unexpected crying, the feeling like you just really need to talk to someone, or like you don't want to talk to anybody at all. Avoiding the topic altogether. Avoiding the feelings of grief, not feeling motivated, not having interest in usual activities, wishing that you could be with other people, but sometimes really wanting to be isolated or just alone, sleeping more or sleeping less, appetite changes, eating less or eating way more than you should. But tonight, I just want to say to you to remember this. You're not going crazy, and your friend is not going crazy. We can take time to just really listen to these stories and just really share even the most mystical experiences. We can make meaning out of them. I was a funeral director many years ago, and I remember going to the crematory with my friend Sharon. Our mutual friend, her husband Jesse, had died, and she really wanted to see his body, but they weren't having a formal service. And I was with her as her funeral director, and she leaned over to give him a kiss. And she said to me, "That's the weirdest thing. I can smell him. I can smell his aftershave." It's these kinds of things, the sense, the sights, the sounds that remind us of our loved one. And it just happens just out of the blue sometimes. But sometimes too, having a new loss and seeing all these stories on television or in the news media can trigger our own emotions from unresolved grief from the past, from prior loss. I was visiting a woman and her husband on the intensive care unit. Her husband was unconscious. He was on a ventilator, and she would come every day and sit by his side. So I got to know her. And after a while, she shared with me that it was in the very same intensive care unit, just a few doors down, that her son had died 15 years earlier. He was in a terrible car accident. And she and her husband did the best they could to just move on with life and deal with their grief. But being there in the ICU with her own husband brought up all of her grief brand new. So you've had a loss, and you know, we've all been going through a really terrible past year. day after day, seeing people on the news, hearing from friends and family about personal experiences. You know, it's just been very recently that someone said to me, you know what, I realized that I'm not hearing the numbers every day anymore. They're not announcing the numbers anymore. It's been a whole year. Remarkably, today is actually the anniversary. But what comes next? How do we cope with our own grief, and how do we move into this new normal? Well, one of the things that we can do is to find a trusted friend, someone who can be a companion to us in our grief, someone that we know loves us unconditionally and will just listen to us. We'll just try to be understanding. We can try to find balance and measure our grief in portions. You know, you can't ignore the emotions, but you can engage in healthy distractions. Maybe a new hobby, maybe healthy exercise. But find time for self-care. Take time away from work, time away from chores at home, and do something that is soothing to you, balm for the soul. I recently saw something in the Blue Zones newsletter. If you're familiar with Blue Zones, they celebrate longevity and well-being and holistic lifestyle. And they said one of the very most healthy things you can do is just to go somewhere like a park and take a bath in the forest. Go out into nature. Engaging in spiritual practices is very helpful. Things like meditation or journaling, and of course, prayer. If you're a person of faith, prayer. Reach out to your spiritual community. Engage with your clergy. Reach out to your pastor, to whomever it is that you go to for spiritual succor. Get enough sleep and rest. I can't say more about that. Rest is so important when you're in grief, and also eating healthy meals. It's so easy to, you know, just shove whatever's available in your face, but so important to eat healthy, life-giving food and move your body, exercise, you know, talk to your doctor if you're not somebody who's been physically active, and engage in activities that are healthy for you. But also, and very importantly, avoid making major life decisions. You know, the death of a loved one, whether it's your spouse, a child, a parent, even a best friend, it's a very significant life event. And it's so important to just pause and, you know, take some time to acknowledge that. Be aware and cautious with the numbing of alcohol and drugs. But most of all, talk about your feelings as often as possible with a trusted friend, maybe in a grief support group or with a therapist. You might have heard of complicated grief. That's when reactions to grief are so intense or distressing that you find it difficult to function. You can't move. You have trouble with sleep, trouble with eating, can't go to work, relationships are suffering. Maybe your feelings and reactions to grief have even become more intense as time goes by. Maybe you're feeling anxiety, anxiousness, or depression. Maybe you have thoughts of suicide or death. I beg you to seek help from a trusted professional. Talk to your medical doctor. Talk to your clergy person. Talk to a therapist. Reach out for help. Reach out to the Riverside Medical Center Charitable Foundation. But a lot of us are here tonight because we know somebody that has sustained a serious loss and they're in grief. And I just want to clarify, when we talk about grief, that's the emotion. Mourning is what we do with grief. It's the activities that we participate in. Things like going to ceremonies, funerals or memorial services. I know that they're starting to let people gather again, but at the very beginning of the pandemic, I counseled more than one person who had a loss, and they weren't even able to schedule a funeral or a gathering. But they are now. And for people who are far away, funeral homes are engaging in virtual gatherings more now than they ever have before. But you can also accept food and hospitality if you're in grief, or if you know somebody who's in grief, you know, start up a food chain, a food group, people that will make casseroles and drop them off, or order Grubhub or DoorDash, or you can be the one that coordinates that. All of these things are very helpful. You can offer transportation. You can help care for someone's pets. You can do errands or chores like dropping off the dry cleaning or arranging for house cleaning. But make sure that you take time and remember to observe special anniversaries and birthdays and holidays. Remember that the person who's in grief might be having their first holiday without their loved one. Participate in spiritual community functions related to the loss, things like annual remembrance ceremonies or grief support groups. Create new routines and activities. And you know, we've all heard that there's things that you shouldn't say, right? Like, he's in a better place. Or, at least he lived a long life. Many people die young. Or how about, you just need to be strong. There's a reason for everything. Or one of my favorites, he did what he did. He did what he needed to come here to do, but it was his time to go. Or, I know how you feel. Sometimes those things are just not helpful. But here's a few things that are helpful. I don't know how you feel. It must be really terrible. But I'm here to help you in any way that I can. Or you might say something like, I wish that I had the right words. Just know that I care. Or just simply say, I'm so sorry for your loss. Offer to help. Tell them, we all need help at times like this, and I am here for you. But if you say that, really, really mean it and be available. You can say something like, I'm always just a phone call away. Or, I'm usually up early or up late. Call me if you need anything. But the key is to reach out to them. Because supporting other people in grief is truly a ministry. It's a ministry of your presence. Sometimes the best thing that we can do is just to listen, just be with them. Just give them a hug. But be patient, because sometimes a person in grief is not ready to share their thoughts and emotions. Sometimes they need a little bit of time. But be compassionate and invite the person in grief to share openly and honestly. Be that non-judgmental, unconditional, safe person for them to share with. Validate their feelings. Accept what they say without imposing your own wisdom. This is not a time to talk about yourself. This is a time to listen to someone talk about their own journey. But listen, listen, and listen again. And remember to take care of yourself along the way. That's so important. So just a word about children. Some of us up here have grandchildren, or we have friends with children. Just to remember that children will often reflect the emotions of the people around them. They may not fully understand what has happened when someone close to them has died. And depending upon their age and their stage of development, they may not know what it means when a person is permanently out of their life. It's of utmost importance to defer to the child's parents when we're teaching them about death. Ask and think about, how do the parents of the children want their children to be told about the death? How do those parents want to explain what a permanent absence means? And what do the parents want to teach their children about where we go after life? We have to really respect that. But there's a lot of activities that we can do with children in grief. We can sit down and tell stories about the one that was lost. Tell our personal stories. We can sit down and look at photographs together. We can create scrapbooks and do crafts, such as like maybe making personal greeting cards to thank people who sent flowers or meals or helps in some way. We can go on a hike with them, go outdoors to the park, do something in nature, and maybe pick some flowers or look at the living creatures, the birds and the butterflies, the animals, and just kind of talk to the children about life and living. And of course, we can cook the favorite foods of the one who passed away, or their favorite, bake their favorite treats, and share that with the children and talk about their loved one. In just a moment, we're going to open it up to discussion and questions, but I would like to share with you this selected bibliography. Here are a few of the sources that I drew from, and if you're interested in learning more about grief theory or various ways of coping with loss, these are some publications that might be helpful. And also some suggested resources. You know, go ahead and take out your phone and take a picture of this screenshot if you want to. I welcome your phone calls if you would like to speak to me individually. If you would like information about local grief support groups, I also have printed materials that I would be more than happy to share with you, specifically about grief and COVID-19, but other types of grief as well. Please feel free to reach out. And so now I'm going to stop sharing my screen and start sharing my camera.
Thank you very much. Gosh, that was an amazing, amazing presentation. I feel such heartfelt empathy for all of just everything that that I've been reading in the chat privately and individually that I've been writing back and forth to different people that have attended, and you've given us such wonderful information to really think about. If anybody wants to put any questions in the chat. We are recording this and we're going to be putting it on our YouTube channel. So if you want to rewatch it or see all of the resources that Carolyn provided, you can certainly do that and share it with your friends and rewatch it, because it's, you know, it's good to hear your very calming, tender voice. You know, as you're explaining how we should take good care of ourselves and you know, walk through the steps of grief. So that's very appreciated. One of the questions that we have is, what do you do and what do you say to someone that you love who says that they're okay, but you know that they're not?
You give them a hug. And you just tell them, I'm here for you. It's one thing to feel and sense and know your loved one's emotions, and you know that they're stuffing their feelings. But as I said earlier, sometimes people just need time and space to really get in touch with what they're feeling. Mm-hmm. And we give them that space, but we also make sure that they know we're close and that we love them and that we're available.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for that. Mm-hmm. Somebody else is asking, what can I do when I have a sudden outburst of crying? That can be very difficult.
Yeah, most definitely. And that happens, you know. I remember when my father first died, my mother, we could be anywhere. We could be in the grocery store at the Gardner, and she would just, you know, literally start crying, or she would talk to her neighbors. And, you know, for about the first year, at any time that she would talk about my father, she would start crying. And, you know, it just happens, and it's okay. And my advice to you is carry a hanky, carry some tissues, get the soft ones with the lotion in them. And, you know, it's really okay. And if you're feeling very, very emotional, I would encourage you to reach out to somebody that you know will listen unconditionally, love you, and just be present for you, because it's normal and it happens.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. We do have another question. Someone writes, what can I do or tell my son when he tells me that it's not fair that he didn't get to say goodbye to his grandma who died of COVID-19?
Yeah, I'm curious how old your son is. So I'll start by saying that that is an experience that millions of people have had.
He's 8 years old.
8 years old. Okay. Yes. That's very young. And so there's some opportunities of ways that you can explain to him about what happened to his grandmother. And what I would encourage you to do is to focus on her life as much as you can. Get out the pictures, cook her favorite dishes, bake her favorite treats for him. Talk about her when she was living and alive as much as you can. Pass on her stories, because that's her legacy. And not to say that we're not doing a bypass, because, you know, the older children, and it's in fact adults that are grappling with not having been able to be with their loved one, that's a very real, painful experience. But for an 8-year-old, I believe that there's an opportunity for you to kind of turn it around and really focus on your mother's legacy or your mother-in-law's legacy. For all of us, you know, folks, I can't tell you, I stopped counting how many times that I was, as a clinical person, you know, in full protective gear at the bedside of a person who was dying, who could not have their family there, holding up my iPhone just so that they could see the face of their loved one behind the ventilator. It was very painful and very real. And we think about, you know, for instance, we've all heard stories about the folks that were put into nursing homes and they died. And then, you know, family members not being able to see them. This is very, very real. And this is a collective human experience that we are all sharing. So I encourage you, if at any time you're feeling yourself welling up with sadness or grief about what you're seeing in the news or maybe personally experienced, I can't encourage you enough to reach out for help. Talk to a trusted friend, talk to someone in authority, like maybe your physician, your therapist, your clergy person, your employer. A lot of businesses have employee assistance programs, but reach out and ask for help. There's grief support groups available. There's a lot of help out there. And the truth is that not one of us has not been touched by what we've all gone through this past year.
Well, that's very good advice to think of. Are you aware of any current online grief support groups that are going on right now?
Absolutely. At the very beginning of the pandemic, we were having twice weekly in-person groups at the hospital. And as soon as the lockdown happened, my facilitators immediately went on to Zoom. So we've been meeting uninterrupted. About maybe 9 months into it, everybody started getting the hang of it. And so right now, today, it doesn't matter if you're in Canada or Baja California, or, you know, the tip of Maine, or, you know, San Diego, you can get into a grief support group. There's grief support groups that are faith-based, and there's grief support groups that are secular. If you're a very spiritual person, you might find it helpful to look on church websites to see what they offer. But if you're a person who's not faith-based and who really doesn't really want religion to be part of your grief experience, there are other secular groups. Hospice agencies will offer online grief support groups. If you go back to the resources that I provided to you, our hospice, Advantage Hospice in Riverside, currently has an online grief support group once a week, and we're adding new ones because there's more people reaching out. So there's lots of opportunities.
Well, that's wonderful. And I'll make sure that we resend out that information and continue to send that out to everybody at that we connect with at the foundation. So thank you very much. I don't see any questions that we currently have, but if you have any others, please feel free to email them to us at a later date. And we can get those questions answered for you. Carolyn, on behalf of everybody and the foundation and our board of trustees, I want to thank you for being there during times that we couldn't be there ourselves to care for our loved ones when they were ill. It really means a lot. So thank you very much. You are a very special, warm, loving person, and we are just lucky to have you here in our presence. I want to thank you very much and thank everybody for being here this evening. We're going to have another webinar with Carolyn next month, so we'll be sending out information in the next few weeks to everybody. Her webinar will be in April, and we invite you all to attend. So thank you again, and have a wonderful evening. Please take care of yourselves.
Thank you.